Good morning. Welcome to this service of the celebration of life of Jeffrey Todd Austin. What a privilege it is to gather in friendship and solidarity with one another and with his family, and be able to mourn together and also be joyful together in the same way that Jeff exuded such joy and compassion and appreciation for one another, for all of his friends and family. We're gathered, of course, to praise God, but there's all kinds of other things that we are doing as well, and one of them is housekeeping. So if you parked in the deck on 9th Street and have a ticket, then that can be validated next to the elevator, and somebody would be glad to show you how if you haven't done that yet. You can do it on the way out. You can do it at any point. Restrooms are located at the bottom of the stairs on either side. Men's on that side, women's on that side. There's an elevator there that will take you down to the fellowship hall and to the restrooms if you prefer to use the elevator. Now I think we might be able to get on with this grand celebration today. So we witness to our faith as we celebrate Jeff's life. And as we all know, it is quite the life to celebrate. And to have had the privilege of knowing Jeff and being part of his life, several people will share memories and insights about Jeff over the course of the next hour. Those folks have been family and friends, and one person who will not be here physically to share his reflection is Stuart Rose, who was a very good friend and helped with the logistics of this service, and who is sick this morning. So when his time for reflection comes, I'll read his notes. The music that we heard as we were gathering was music that Jeff loved, and his friends were saying things like Linda Ronstadt, Dr. Zhivago, Moody Blues, all kinds of things. And so we thank Stephen Branion for doing the work on the piano to bring us some of that music before moving over back to the organ. But that music, along with the hymns, gives us some insight and clues into his wide-ranging interests and his complex personality. Everything reflects him so well. The hymns reflect his joy, his service, his faith, and his resurrection. Yes, there is so much to celebrate. And in the midst of that celebration, of course, is our intense grief as we acknowledge our loss of a loved one lost way too soon. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Our first hymn speaks to joy. It's Joyful, Joyful, hymn number 89 in the United Methodist Hymnal. Please stand as you're able.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us who have gone on before, some just weeks ago, some years, but they remain in our hearts and we name them before you. Especially today, we praise you for Jeffrey Todd Austin, husband, son, brother, uncle, colleague, friend. You have now received him into your holy and loving presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and through their spirits and memories, upon us, until such time as we might join them and you in the joy of your home and heart and haven. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Our first person offering reflections is Jeff's sister, Jan.
Can you hear me? Oh, you can. Okay. So I want to share perspectives of Jeff from a sister's point of view. He and I were rather a study in opposites. He was tall and thin. You can see what I am. In fact, my father, who is famous for his humor, once said that if a scientist looked at our family photo, they might think that we were pioneers in genetic engineering. You also may notice that I am wearing orange. Orange was Jeff's favorite color. Mine was purple, and I'm sure you're familiar with the concept of color wheels. And when you look on a color wheel, purple and orange are opposites. They're complementary colors. But when you use them together, you can really make the other color stand out. So I think Jeff helped me stand out, and that in certain ways, I helped him stand out. The first way that I helped him stand out was to give him an opportunity to shine. And that was when I was born, and he got to become my big brother. And he was the most amazing big brother from the very, very start. He was my protector. Other than chicken pox, he got chicken pox and then he gave it to me. But I don't think there was a whole lot he could do about that. He was my teacher. He went to school before I went to school, and he came home and he taught me what he had learned. And I was reading fairly proficiently by the time I was four. And as I grew a little bit older and some of the more interesting parts of my personality developed, he was also my tolerator. Put up with my bratty and impish behavior. And to the best of my knowledge, I don't think he ever ratted me out for any of the terrible things that I did. And as we got a little older, our differences became, to me, even more noticeable. We would sit together, maybe when he was 8 or 9, and we would do the spirograph and make all the designs, and we would have Etch-a-Sketches. I'm glad there's people with gray hair here so you know what I'm talking about. I do not have to explain. And I remember him saying, I'm going to design things when I grow up. He was maybe 9 or 10. I think Jeff was born sort of knowing what he was meant to do. It took me until I was in my 40s to go to nursing school and get my degree. So another big difference. Again, as we were in our childhood, it was an interesting dynamic because we had different loves. We learned to swim together. He didn't like the water. I did. So during summer times, I was up at the pool doing my thing, swimming on the swim team, and Jeff was doing Jeff, and I'm not exactly sure what that was during that time because I was so involved with what I was doing. You know, we would come home, have dinner, have our Bible study, and go to bed. I don't know what he did during the day. Until we moved when I think I was 12, and he was in the 8th grade, and he did not want to give up his 9th grade year at his current junior high school. So he got up every morning, rain, snow, sleet, sun. No, he wasn't a postman, but he rode his bike over to Randolph Junior High School so that he could continue to be with his core group of friends and then move on to East Mecklenburg where he went to high school. That inspired me. I also rode my bike every morning during the summer to swim team practice and hung out at the Charlotte Swim Club all day. Jeff was being far more industrious than I was, though. He began a paper route to make money, and then from there they morphed into mowing lawns with a friend of his from high school, landscaping. He was doing landscaping. And I believe with that money, he ended up with both a car and a motorcycle during high school. And, you know, that's just pretty amazing. He then sold that car and motorcycle and bought an MGB GT. So he was driving a classic car to school when he was a senior. But he never left me behind. When we moved into our new house, he also bought a stereo. He had a huge love for music, as you've already heard. I, of course, was sulking because I didn't have a stereo. And my ingenious father took speakers from the old speaker, a stereo console that sat in our dining room, drilled a hole in the wall, and wired the speakers through so that when Jeff was listening to music, I could listen to music. And that, for the most part, was wonderful. He did develop a celebrity crush on Linda Ronstadt, though. And I thought, if I heard, "When will I be loved?" one more time, I was going to break the record in half. Fortunately, I could turn off the speakers, so when he was listening to something I didn't want to listen to, I was able to have the peace and quiet in my room. But music was so important to Jeff that, especially through these last several years when he and I were a lot closer, we basically could not have some kind of communication without one of us referencing lyrics from a song that were relative to what we were talking about. So I got sidetracked. I said, through it all, Jeff was there for me, even driving me to my friends' houses. And he drove me to school every day his senior year. He didn't make me get out a block away and walk in case someone saw me. He loved me the way that we know he loved, even way back then. After high school, he went off, of course, to UNCC, and you're going to hear more about that later from Rick. And we were doing all of our separate things. I graduated from high school. I saw him on family occasions. His marriage to Jessica was quite an event. And they moved, I believe, to Florida for a few years, lived in the Jacksonville, Mandarin area. And we stayed in touch. He actually visited, I have lived in many places, but I was living on St. Simon's Island, I believe, when you all were in Jacksonville. They came up for a visit. It was a very unfortunate day for them to come. It happened to be 9/11/2001. So that visit was not the most opportunity for us to reconnect. He also came and visited me in Seattle when I was in nursing school. And that was really a wonderful visit. He loved the city, loved, of course, the architecture, just the adventure and the fun. And he visited me also when I was in Portland several times. And I think that was when he and I really began to connect as adults and appreciate each other and also recognize a lot of the things that we actually did have in common rather than thinking, you know, he's the responsible one, Jan's over here doing whatever she's doing, Jeff is, you know, working 5 days a week, oh, Jan is, you know, doing this over here. So we began to understand each other a lot more. I moved back here in 2017 and to be close for when my mom was getting close to end of life. And we really got close then. We were back in the same time zone. It's hard sometimes when you're 3 hours away to actually be able to have phone conversations. We met for breakfasts. And I learned so much about his big brain and his big mind. And I equate those with intelligence and creativity. They're sort of one and the same, but they work together. He had such bold ideas. He was way ahead of his time. He was always out of the box before out of the box even existed as a descriptive word. And he just figured everything out. And he did it in a measured and, what's the best word? Not detached, because he cared, but he took the emotion out of the situation so that you could focus on what you really needed to do. I also learned a lot about his great big heart and his great big soul. Jessica, he loved you so much. He loved his mini. You might have seen it outside. He loved his family. He loved food. He went and took chef classes several years earlier and made some wonderful meals for us. He was quite a connoisseur of wine when he came out to visit me in Portland. We toured through the Willamette. Yes, it's Willamette, not Willamette. Willamette Valley, which has become quite prominent and well known for their wines. do I dare say, gin and bourbon. He had a certain affinity for the fine-er gins and the small batch bourbons. And I learned about his work and his service. And as you know, he has service right here in this church. And as we talked, many of our conversations ended up revolving around one really big thing we both believed to be the purpose of life. Something I sought to embrace while he also had separately learned, and both of us likely through the example of our mother's love, and that is unconditional love. It's simple to understand. It is what it says it is, love without condition, removing the ego and removing the judgment and removing expectations of anything in return. All you have to do is love with empathy and acceptance. Jeff did exactly that. And it reminds me of a very short poem I'll now share. It's written by Hafiz, a Persian poet from the 14th century. And he wrote, "And still, after all this time, the sun never says to the earth, you owe me. Look what happens with a love like that. It lights the whole sky." Jeff lit up my whole world and the world of many others with a love like that. And that's how I remember him.
Thank you, Jan. Our first reading today comes from the book of Micah, chapter 6, verses 6 to 8. "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings and calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?" Please stand as you're able, and let's sing hymn number 2172 in The Faith We Sing, "We Are Called," which is based on that scripture. completed. And now we'll have reflections by Minette Curl and then Rick Bartlett.
Testing? All right. Don't blame me, Jan. I look around this room and I see some of the most impressive people I've ever had the pleasure of meeting and working with. People who I have watched hold each other through the struggles of life, people who have shaped the skyline of this city and the policies and guided companies through difficult times. People who showed up for their communities, beliefs, and each other. These are the kind of people Jeff attracted and nurtured. I've talked with many of you this week as we've processed the pain of losing Jeff, and we all struggled to put words to describing him and what it was that made him such a unique force in our lives and irreplaceable. Jeff was a very open person, yet it's so hard to explain what it is that made him so special. He was, without question, brilliant. But that's clear from his accomplishments, which we'll hear more about later. He was a great thinker who absorbed the world around him in every way, took the time to process it, and then took that to the rest of us, inspiring us with his insights and clarity into what was really going on and what mattered in the long run. On paper, he was unquestionably amazing, but in person, he was so much more. I met Jeff around 12 years ago when I was working with the bank as a contractor, and Jeff was this funny enigma that I would see in the office. We would have a friendly chat in the break room getting our coffee, often starting with a compliment on one of his colorful shirts or our mutual appreciation of cowboy boots. He was always very nice to me, but I didn't really know exactly what it was he did. I learned later that his job was to think. Thank you, Bob Burgess. What I also watched with Jeff was that he had more lunch dates with women than Don Draper. Seriously, I would watch him head out chatting and laughing with a different woman on a weekly basis, if not twice a week. Then one day when I told him I was wrapping up my contract work and would be leaving soon, he asked me to grab lunch. I was really struck by the kindness of this gesture. It was a very difficult time at the bank, and there wasn't a lot of space for random acts of kindness. Fortunately, a few months after that contract ended, I ended up joining the bank permanently, and the lunches continued. Then when he retired, I teased him about his gaggle of women he was leaving behind. Seriously, the star quarterback would have been jealous of the cast of women who lined up to have lunch with this man. After his retirement, Jeff and I stayed in touch, and the friendship only got better as our conversations expanded past work to the more meaningful activities of the world. He was the person who would happily meet me on what he called the mysterious East Side. And for those of you who've been in Charlotte a long time, some of this will have meaning to you. We would grab lunch at one of our favorite classic haunts like Loopy's. If anyone knows Loopy's, yep. They still have $1 gee whiz beers. Or if schedules were tight and we just needed one of those great Jeff and Annette conversations, and that's what he referred to the two of us as. Jeff and Minette was Jeff and Annette. We would go grab a drink at the Diamond. Clearly, we are not a classy pair. And I would laugh at him, and this would happen all the time, as he would just start chatting up the bartender or the person that was near us and didn't have anyone with them. That's just who he was. Very inclusive. Our conversations were all over the board and very animated. We could talk about how the threads of issues across the world are actually connected. We could dissect heartbreaking events in the world and in our personal lives and find the good in them. They were the kind of deep, thoughtful conversations that feed the soul. We often laughed at how people would see us talking intensely and laughing, and how they couldn't figure out the dynamics of our relationship. We were an odd pair. But Jeff had that effect on people. He changed lives through conversations, not with the goal of changing people or converting them, but just by having conversations on a connected level and truly listening and having a two-way dialogue. During COVID, as we all were struggling to make our way through the strange new world we got plunged into, Patrice Cosgrove, Jeff, and I started a book club. We felt it would give us something to discuss other than the day-to-day mess the world was in. Since Patrice and I were part of Jeff's original gaggle at the bank, we were dubbed the Jaggle, Jeff's gaggle, and he was the president. The books selected rotated from person to person as we agreed that we needed to get out of our usual reading ruts and explore different genres, a very Jeff-like plan. As I remember, we read around 14 books together, and boy, did they cover a broad range. But no question, Jeff was the one that brought some of the most unusual ones. There was this one Japanese book that was probably not the best translation either. And you know what? Audible does not do books for obscure, does not do readings of obscure books. So he forced us to read these books. It was the only way. There were only three of us. You couldn't show up unprepared. And we teased him about some of the book choices he made because they were always obscure. But I loved that he opened doors to things that I wouldn't have been exposed to otherwise. And then it made me think about the world and the impact of events for people who live in a very different culture from the one that we're in. So, and he was good-natured about the teasing, but he did change all of our lives. Jeff had such a playful side, and he will forever own flamingos for me. And I have to tell you, after Monday morning, flamingos were all but flying in the door of my home. They were just everywhere, always seeing flamingos, because it was always Jeff and the flamingos. But they became a symbol of the jaggle. Patrice, during COVID, Patrice and I flocked him. We planted pink plastic flamingos in his yard. And then he dressed them in different outfits and would watch his neighbors take pictures of them. Jeff loved making people smile. And he would get on these Zoom calls like this. So for all of you that thought he was a very serious person, trust me, Jeff wore this much better than I do. But he did love making people smile. While I was writing down my thoughts for today, I got a call from a friend who has an artisan granola shop on the coast. And he had met Jeff. And thank you so much, Jessica, for calling them. You're stronger than I. I couldn't call them. I couldn't tell them. He had met Jeff years ago and was always looking forward to the visits when he was on island. And he heard about Jeff's passing, and he asked me to tell you all that he was a quiet, gentle giant who gave me great advice. I think that might be the best summary of what Jeff meant to all of us, because it is so hard to put words to it, but that's a universal aspect of it. And finally, Jeff loved the bumper sticker, surround yourself with people who feel like sunshine, and that's how he lived. He was our sunshine, and all of you were his. I am so happy to have had him in my life. Thank you.
My name is Richard Bartlett, formerly known as Rick, which is who I was until after graduating college. I am going to focus on Jeff's early life during the time I was Rick. My family moved to Charlotte from Canada in July of 1977, and I met Jeff in August while starting architecture at UNCC. He promptly informed me that he was enamored with all things Canadian, so I went with it and became his friend. Now, just because I was his friend doesn't mean I shared his talent in writing or speaking. So I want you to lower your expectations as I bumble through this. We often spent time with each other's respective families, and these were the days when there wasn't any cell phones, no social media, no YouTube, no streaming. Jeff provided much needed entertainment for numerous family dinners on the weekends. He would have us in stitches, often at his own expense, and he received the enduring nickname Moose, most likely due to his stellar physique or lack thereof. He was a consummate dreamer in school, and when he found out that a regional carrier called Piedmont Airlines had a $49 special on their inaugural connection to San Francisco, Jeff announced we were going. We scrambled together some cash since neither one of us had a credit card, and off we went. Arriving at 2 a.m. In the morning at the St. Francis Hotel, our room wasn't ready, of course, and which, by the way, was a four-star hotel now, and then was a no-star hotel. Consequently, we found ourselves in Union Square, hanging out until we came across a chalk outline of a murder victim, and we figured we're out of our league, so we headed back to the hotel and camped out in the lobby. San Francisco was also where I got introduced to Jeff's association with the Brethren Church. They had never met either one of us, but they took us into their houses, fed us, and toured us around the city for 3 days. The only rules were no alcohol, no dancing, but they were really nice people, so again, I went with it. Eventually, my brother Steve and I decided it was time to take Moose to the promised land. That would be Canada. And somehow we thought the three of us traveling 800 miles to the Great White North in a two-seater Fiat Spider was okay. There was a small space behind the seat that if one sat sideways, leaning against a pillow and put your arm out over the trunk since the top was down, it worked for a third person. Thankfully, it didn't rain and we made it after 13 hours of hard driving. We did the typical touristic thing and started in Kingston, then went to Toronto, then Ottawa, then we went to Montreal and it didn't go so well. He wasn't keen on not being able to understand what people were saying around him, so he requested we leave sooner than we planned. I understood later in life he tried to redeem himself with the French people by planning a trip to Paris, which unfortunately didn't come to fruition. Must not have been too bad, though, since he took Jessica back to English-speaking Canada on his honeymoon. We were usually in the same classes for 4 years and went on various field trips with school, including New York, Washington, Charleston, and Savannah. We both fell in love with boarded-up, old, deteriorating Charleston in the late 70s, and it was fitting that it was the MUSC doctors in the Holy City that later sustained him. In the fall of 1979, Jeff and I moved together as roommates into another run-down, dilapidated neighborhood called Dilworth. It was the hood back then, as opposed to the multi-million-dollar houses of today, which I'm sure is because we discovered it. We often cooked dinner together, switching between fried rice and spaghetti. That's all we had. Jeff eventually figured out that we could add some variety by introducing cooking sherry, which was the first indication that he was destined to become a foodie. Our roommateship came to an end after Jeff met the lovely Miss Jessica Seide. He spent countless hours doodling J&J in different graphic fashions and branding the institution of Jeff and Jessica. In 1982, he moved out of my bubble and into Jessica's, and they lived happily ever after. At Jeff's insistence, we continued to have breakfast once a month at the original House of Pancake, which is the best breakfast in town, by the way. He had determined that he was a thinker, as other people have said, and I was a doer. So he often triple-dog dared me to reach for a higher plane, knowing that I love to challenge. Some of them were successful and others were a disaster that I'm not going to go into, but I have to say that I am living a more fulfilled life because of him. Fast forwarding to the present, I am often referred to as Jeff's best friend, but I was just a friend. Jessica was his true hero. Jessica. Jessica, you were his rock upon which he stood. He would reach up into the stratosphere, and you were his tether. I watched you laugh and cry together. As his disease chipped away at him year after year for the past 20, he battled on with you, for you, and because of you. And I was so inspired with your 24/7 loving care and attentiveness as he slipped away these past several weeks. After Jeff passed, we were going through his files looking for his will, which we did find, and I came across hundreds of song lyrics that he had collected, which Jan had referred to as well. Not now I know what he was doing with them. But at any rate, I'd like to close with a medley of song titles that were labeled Reflections of a Boomer. I don't know if Jeff wrote this or not, but it was pretty cool. I got to get a rhythm going here. I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've been through the desert on a horse with no name. I've gone to Kansas City. I've sung in the sunshine. I've been on the road again with Georgia on my mind. Like a rolling stone, I've given peace a chance. I put my camel to bed and danced the last dance. Mr. Tambourine Man played a song for me. I've whispered words of wisdom, let it be. I fell into a burning ring of fire and walked the line. To all the girls I've loved before, you were always on my mind. I've been at, that's the gaggle. Or the jaggle, as you said, the jaggle. I've been everywhere. I've been so lonesome I could cry. I've driven my Chevy to the levee when the levee was dry. I've been to Ichiku Park in a yellow submarine. I've made the scene in a time machine. I've done the hokey pokey and turned myself around. I've welcomed baby back to the poor side of town. I've followed the tracks of my tear down a long and winding road. I've kept on searching for a heart of gold. I sought shelter from the storm. I've sat on the dock of the bay. I've rocked around the clock on a sunshiny day. I've knocked on heaven's doors, blowing in the wind, joy to the world. Those were the days, my friend. Lay, lady, lay in crimson and clover. It's been a hard day's night. The party is over. Thank you for being my friend. And through our belief in Jesus Christ, we will see you again. I added those last two things.
Our next reading is from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be God's peoples. God's very self will be with them. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." Now, these are the words of his friend, Stuart Rose, his good friend, who couldn't be here today because he's sick. If you asked me a few weeks ago, "How well do you know Jeff Austin?" I would have dared to say that I was blessed to know Jeff for the last 20 years. And yes, I do know him fairly well. Well, please forgive my hubris. In the past few days, in talking about, through reading about Jeff and his many accomplishments, I have quickly realized that I was not at all aware of the many layers of his life, of the richness of his personality and experiences. I had no idea that Jeff played in the marching band at East Mecklenburg High School. Did you? Jeff and I had many points of connection. We both loved the beach at Oak Island and the barbecue house in particular. Jeff and Jessica often came back with an extra pound of pulled pork and a bottle of their special sauce to share with us. Hague and Sons was our favorite fishmonger. Jeff would describe their catch of the day and the meal he prepared with Jessica. I had no idea that Jeff took cooking classes and was an accomplished chef of long standing. I would have enjoyed cooking together and could have learned a lot, I'm sure. We both enjoyed going to night's baseball games, and I was a member of the cartel that Jeff organized to share season tickets. He got great seats behind the third base dugout, and we would have a cold one and talk. Perhaps Jeff enjoyed the slower pace of baseball games just because it encouraged conversation. Jeff once wrote that questions are more vital than the answers, and the ensuing conversations are more valuable than the self-created diatribes. As an architect, Jeff's goal became to develop the competency to integrate the power of place to the needs of the human spirit. He also worked as a project manager, a process manager, and Malcolm Baldrige examiner, a strategic initiatives leader, and a sustainability strategist. What strikes me across all of those different roles is that they are all focused on helping people work effectively and collaboratively with more lasting results. Jeff may have worked on buildings, but he worked so well with people. Jeff and I worked together at Wachovia, Wells Fargo Bank, for about 8 years on energy and sustainability programs and strategies. Jeff challenged us to think broadly, to consider new ideas fully, and to be creative in solving problems. He led the project to conceive, design, and build a learning center that broke new ground in functionality and delivery. Jeff was an integral part of the team that envisioned, designed, and built the LEED Platinum certified office tower, formerly the Duke Energy Center. For the past 6 years, Jeff was a vital member of First Church's Second Century Project Steering Committee, serving as project manager and process thinking champion. Jeff showed us that while the task at hand was important, how the task was accomplished, how the people involved participated, were more important and usually longer lasting. Jeff and I talked about faith and life. Jeff lived with the courage of his convictions in his work, in his relationships, and most importantly, in living his faith in Christ in thought, word, and deed. His servant heart was big enough to embrace so many friends with generosity and empathy. Here at First Church, Jeff and Jessica were active participants in the Muffin Ministry with unhoused neighbors. They served food and had conversations. Jeff made gallons of coffee and served a cup of Jeff to hundreds. He washed dishes and made many friends here, especially Paul and Adam. Jeff watched out for many and helped them with their needs quietly. One of Jeff's true gifts was in building relationships with friends and colleagues. He was always fully present and engaged. It didn't matter if you talked with Jeff every week or after weeks had passed. When you connected with him, he was all in. Jeff was the consummate listener and had a way of making you feel that you were very important to him. And that was quite true. We were. And yet he did this over and over again with so many people that were blessed to call him friend. Each of us here today knew Jeff in the context of our relationship with him as son, husband, brother, uncle, work colleague, and friend. If we add layer upon layer of what we each know of Jeff and his life, we can begin to appreciate the extent of his knowledge and experience, the richness of his relationships, as rich and varied as his musicology. Many, many adjectives have been used this week in describing Jeff, his life and presence. Several words keep repeating: humble, servant, calm, understanding, and most often, a man of God. I was blessed to have known Jeff for 20 years. By example, Jeff showed me that how is more important than what, that relationships blossom with attention and nurturing, that life is deeper and richer for the people with whom we share the journey. Several times already, I've wondered, what would Jeff say about this matter or that? I will miss his friendship greatly and hope I can remember some of what Jeff Austin lived out so fully. This next reading is by Mahatma Gandhi. It's In the Midst of Darkness. I do dimly perceive that while everything around me is ever changing, ever dying, there is underlying all that change a living power that is changeless, that holds all together, that creates, dissolves, and recreates. That informing power or spirit is God. And since nothing else that I see merely through the senses can or will persist, he alone is. And is this power benevolent or malevolent? I see it as purely benevolent, for I can see that in the midst of death, life persists. In the midst of untruth, truth persists. In the midst of darkness, light persists. Hence, I gather that God is life, truth, light. God is love. God is the supreme good. I can echo everything that everyone else has already said. I knew the playful Jeff and the intelligent Jeff and the Jeff who would wear flamingos. I knew Jeff as a friend and a colleague in the Second Century Project. I also knew him in Muffin Ministry. In fact, that was how we first met years ago. He was, by the time I got there in the morning, he had done serving the coffee or the folks and had moved on to a very instrumental job in Muffin Ministry, the dishes. So he was usually in the corner of the kitchen with steam all around from the dishwasher, doing all of these dishes over and over and trying to scrape pans clean and get them through the line, get coffee cups through so they could go through again for the guests. And he was so quietly friendly and so content doing this very necessary job Sunday morning after Sunday morning. A few weeks ago, I was volunteering one night here at our room in the inn time, and I was doing dishes at that dishwasher. I texted Jeff and said that I was channeling my inner Jeff Austin. He replied that he thought that was the best job of all. I wish I'd pursued it and asked why. But I think it may be that it was just him living out his call to be of service, to walk humbly with God. That is so much of what he did, so quietly, so persistently, so perfectly. Jeff worked on, if you could call it work, he worked on his relationship with the holy in much of the same ways that he worked on his relationships with family and friends and colleagues. He worked on that relationship with care and with deep respect and curiosity and openness. Over these past years, he started practicing meditation as well as prayer, and remarked that both of those practices helped to sustain him on some of the scarier nights of late. He read deeply and listened to the podcast of The Marginalian, a platform dedicated to the study of the marginalia of life and how that creates and sustains us. It's the holy over so many different genres, and much of it is as complex and fascinating as Jeff himself. And I so appreciate that depth, his questions, his acceptance and joy even in the ability and the necessity and the possibility to keep on learning, to keep on diving deeper, to keep on absorbing the lessons of love in whatever forms they were presenting themselves. He took that expression of love so seriously and translated it in so many different ways. One of his favorite sayings, "If not you, who? If not now, when?" He thought deeply and he acted, and thought and acted. I also appreciate his frustration with the fact that his body was giving out before his mind and heart and soul. These last several months have been so difficult on so many levels. And he came to terms with depending on friends and relatives, and especially Jessica, to help him navigate the inner sanctums of the healthcare system and his own body and the relationships between them all. So complicated, sometimes needlessly and sometimes heartlessly, but he was still trying to figure it all out and to figure out how to best get to the best solution, even if the goal kept morphing. And he kept doing it with such a generosity of spirit and a spirit of forgiveness, a spirit of genuine acceptance, even as he was still exploring possibilities. And so I appreciate, too, the promise from the book of Revelation that God will dwell among us, and I think is dwelling among us, and that tears and mourning and pain will be no more. Jeff's pain is healed. How wonderful is that? We are still, of course, mourning, and we will still mourn, but there is joy mixed with our tears, and his spirit still lives among us and between us. He has continued to witness to that power that holds us all together, creating, dissolving, and recreating us. This good power Jeff attested to in so many ways, as he was living and even as he was moving closer to physical death. He could see and demonstrate that life persisted even on the bleakest days. He could still perceive that truth, capital T truth, persisted. He could still see the light, sending Jessica a picture of the sunrise from the hospital every morning. And Jeff is now a part of that power and truth and light in the presence of and a constituent part of the God who is love, who is unconditional love. Thanks be to God for that love and for the person of Jeffrey Todd Austin. Let us pray. God of us all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Jeff to us, now we give Jeff back to you. Receive him into the arms of your mercy. Raise him up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into new life. Help us to love and serve you in this world and to enter into your joy in the world to come. And God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us, for the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence in these days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends. We praise you for Jeff's life among us, for the many ways he shared himself and witnessed to you. We thank you, too, for Jesus, who knew our griefs and who lives and prays for us. As he taught us, so now we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please now stand as you're able, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, 5, and 6 of hymn number 711, For All the Saints. Before receiving the blessing, I invite you downstairs to the fellowship hall where there will be some refreshments and you can greet the family. There will not be a receiving line per se, so just go on down and help yourself and then see the family members that you would like to see or be seated. Any of those, I remind you that there is a validation machine by the elevator. If you haven't yet validated your parking ticket, do that and somebody will help you. After the blessing, I'll lead the family out and then you all come down as you will. And now may the God who holds us up and embraces us so fully be with you, that God who continues to create, to redeem, and to sustain us now and forevermore. Amen. On down the stairs, or you take the elevator if that's easier.
Well done. Appreciate it. Thank you. Lord bless you.
I'll see you down there. Okay.
Where's the elevator?
That elevator would go down to the street, right?
Thank you, Val. Appreciate it very much.
We'll see you downstairs.